Hey, I have an announcement. I wrote a book. It's called Tales of the Prehistoric World. It features over 60 stories of paleontological discoveries with illustrations by Becky Thorns. It's rated for ages 8 to 10, but also anyone young at heart. You can order it through your local bookseller or wherever else books are sold. On December 6, 1834, a young Charles Darwin was visiting San Pedro Island off the coast of southern Chile. It was the latest stop on his long voyage around the world, the one where he began to develop his ideas about the origin of species. On the island, he noticed a tiny fox-like creature, a canid of some sort, sitting on the rocks, completely absorbed in watching the men working. The species was unknown to Western science and different from the other canids Darwin had seen in South America. So, as the group's naturalist, he decided to collect a specimen to send back to England. The fox was so distracted that he was able to sneak up behind it and knock it on the head with his geology hammer. Not cool, Darwin. He'd later describe that poor fox as more curious or more scientific, but less wise than the generality of his brethren. In other words, curiosity killed the canid. Today, we call this species Darwin's fox, and it's one of 10 very different canid species that call South America home, the most diverse canid community found anywhere on Earth. But while Darwin collected the fox for science, he'd never know the real scientific story it and those other canids represented, though he probably would have loved it. Because while South America today has the most canid species, until relatively recently, it had none. And the origin of these species? Well, just like the finches of the Galapagos that would inspire him later on, it turns out that South America's canids are the result of an adaptive evolutionary radiation. One driven by great migrations, insurmountable geological barriers, and new ecological opportunities. These canids were, in a sense, the finches that Darwin missed. It would take nearly two centuries of further research and development of entirely new fields of science for us to finally figure out how South America got its canids. And the reason that it was so mysterious for so long is because the whole situation is kind of odd. See, despite South America having the greatest canid diversity of any continent, it was clear that they must have only arrived fairly recently. After all, North America, not South, was the cradle of canid evolution. That's where the fossil record shows canids originated and evolved for tens of millions of years, as far back as the late Eocene epoch, around 40 million years ago. Some groups rose and fell in North America, and in the late Miocene epoch, around 6 million years ago, some groups migrated into Eurasia, giving rise to all modern Eurasian and African canids. But canid migration into South America could have only become possible more recently, within just the last 3 to 4 million years, following the formation of the Isthmus of Panama in the late Pliocene epoch. This land bridge enabled an exchange of many species between the two continents in a series of events called the Great American Biotic Interchange. And for a long time, biologists have been trying to figure out why the canids of South America are so diverse when they only arrived recently. Did they diversify in North America and migrate south separately? Or did they suddenly radiate from a single common ancestor into radically different species once they arrived? Well, the fossil record of canids in South America is pretty patchy, so it can't give us many clear answers to those questions. But if you can't trace a story forward in time from ancient evidence, then you have to trace it back in time from modern evidence. And today, we can do this by digging into and comparing the genomes of living species to reconstruct their evolutionary history. It's an approach that I think is fair to say would have blown Darwin's mind. See, he knew nothing about DNA, and even today, genomes are sometimes mistakenly just thought of as molecular recipe books for building organisms. But they're also historical records, as the pattern of mutations and genetic diversity they contain reflect an organism's evolutionary history. From the migrations of their ancestors to the population expansions and bottlenecks they underwent to the selective pressures they faced and more. And with enough genomic data, sufficient computing power, and the right algorithms, it's now possible to reconstruct the history of populations far back into deep time, even with few fossils available. So in 2022, scientists published the results of a study applying this approach to solve the mystery of South America's canids. Using a mix of new and previously sequenced genomes, they compared all 10 living species from across the continent. And the family tree they built showed that despite their many physical and ecological differences, all 10 descended from a single common ancestor that lived just 3.9 to 3.5 million years ago. And based on patterns of genetic diversity, they estimated that this ancestral population was fairly small, with only around 11,600 breeding individuals. This suggests that all South American canids stem from a single dispersal event of one ancestral species from North America over the developing Isthmus of Panama. This single species gave rise to the most diverse canid community on Earth in just a few million years, a staggeringly fast and large-scale radiation for a group of mammalian carnivores. But that ancient canid lineage would first have been faced with a major geological barrier. See, the Andes Mountains had reached their present-day elevation by 6 million years ago and stretched the length of the continent. And using a statistical approach called biogeographic modeling, the researchers estimated that while canids today are found on both the eastern and western sides of the mountains, the ancestral species actually only entered via the east. This suggests they came from Central America to the east side of South America by way of a natural corridor of grassy woodland. We know from fossil evidence that many other North American mammal groups also used this route during the Great American Biotic Interchange, so it seems like the Andes were a major barrier to Western dispersal. And the researchers found the genetic signal of a massive increase in population size once those early canids arrived, a result of the enormous ecological opportunities they found there. They faced very little direct competition in their new environment, as the few South American carnivores like the marsupials and terror birds played very different ecological roles. So the canids were unlike anything else on the continent, which allowed them to thrive and radiate into a range of unoccupied niches. Based on their genomic analysis, the researchers also found that the first lineage to branch off was a group containing the bush dog and the maned wolf, which, despite their obvious differences, are actually sister taxa. Much like the finches of the Galapagos, the distinctiveness of these canids from each other is the result of wildly different niches that they fill. The maned wolf became adapted for navigating through tall grasslands and developed an omnivorous diet, including lots of fruit, while the bush dog specialized as a small but powerful hypercarnivore. Despite having a common ancestor just 3.1 million years ago, around half the divergence time of us and chimps, these two sister canids adapted so differently to their environment that they lost almost all family resemblance. Tracking the radiation of the rest of the canids, the researchers found they continued to diversify on the eastern side of the Andes as they expanded farther south. This gave rise to a second group that includes the crab-eating fox and short-eared dog. Then, starting around 1.4 million years ago, the six fox-like species in the genus Lycalopex began to diverge. And by 1 million years ago, a lineage of this group finally made it to the west side of the Andes. The researchers' modeling suggested they went down and around the mountains, a journey of thousands of kilometers along the southern edge of the range. Talk about taking the scenic route. And this probably happened during dry periods of the Pleistocene epoch that drove the expansion of more grassy woodland corridors that they could cross. This lineage gave rise to the three species on the western side of the range, including our friend Darwin's fox in a final burst of speciation. When he encountered that fox on San Pedro Island, Darwin had no idea that it too had only recently made it there as part of an epic transcontinental journey of its own. And he never found out that this radiation of 10 canids from one small ancestral population was actually an unusually powerful example of the evolutionary process he would later propose in The Origin of Species. The process by which, in his own words, from so simple a beginning, endless forms most beautiful and most wonderful have been and are being evolved.
Don't forget our 2023 calendar featuring 14 reconstructions of some of our favorite main characters of paleontology from classic eons episodes are available now at complexlycalendars.com.
And thanks to this month's foxy eontologists, Jaxi Weiss, Colton, Melanie Lamb Carnivale, Chase Archambault, Annie and Eric Higgins, John Davidson Ng, and Jake Hart. By becoming an Eonite at patreon.com/eons, you'll get fun perks like submitting a joke for us to read. Here's one from Andrew M. Did you hear about the species of skunk that evolved to lose their stink gland? They went extinct. That was good. Good job. And as always, thank you for joining me in the Adam Lowe studio. Subscribe at youtube.com/eons for more prehistoric stories. Oh, this is so... We'll try one with. We'll try one without. Oh. The fox was so distracted that he was able to sneak up behind it and knock it on the head with his geology hammer. Not cool, Darwin. Not cool. It's so bad.
Okay. That's so terrifying.
It's so bad. Oh, it's so bad. Okay, one without.